For what purpose does the distinguished speaker seek recognition?
Mr. Speaker, I ask unanimous consent to speak out of order for 1 minute.
Without objection.
All right. Thank you. Mr. Speaker, I rise today to inform you that I will resign as Speaker of the House effective upon the election of my successor. I will also resign as the representative from Ohio's 8th District at the end of this month. I leave with no regrets, no burdens. If anything, I leave the way I started. I'm just a regular guy, humbled by the chance to do a big job. That's what I'm most proud of. I'm still just me, the same guy who came here 25 years ago as a small businessman and spent all these 25 years trying to just be me. Now, sometimes my staff thought I was too much like me, but it really is the thing I'm most proud of. I'm the same regular guy that came here to try to do a good job for my district and my country. But before I go, I want to express what an honor has been to serve with all of you. The People's House is, in my view, the great embodiment of the American dream. Everybody here comes from somewhere, and everybody here is on some mission. You know, I come from a part of the world where we're used to working. As far back as I can remember, I was working. My staff was asking me the other day, well, you know, on November 1st, you're not going to have a job. When was the last time you didn't have a job? And I thought about it, thought about it. I thought, well, I had to be 8 or 9 years old because I was throwing newspapers back then and working in my dad's bar. As a matter of fact, I used to work from 5 a.m. on Saturday morning until 2 p.m. for $2. Not $2 an hour, $2. I never thought about growing up as the easy way or the hard way. It was just the Cincinnati way. And you know, our city takes its name from a great Roman general, Cincinnatus, a farmer who answered the call of his nation to lead and then surrendered his power to go back to his plow. For me, it wasn't a farm, it was a small business. And it wasn't so much a calling as it was a mission. A mission to strive for a smaller, less costly, and more accountable federal government here in Washington. How do we do? Here's some facts. For the first time in nearly 20 years, we've made some real entitlement reforms, saving trillions of dollars over the long term. We've protected 99% of the American people from an increase in their taxes. We're on track to save taxpayers $2.1 trillion over the next 10 years, the most significant spending reductions in modern times. We've banned earmarks altogether. Sorry. We've protected this institution. We've made it more open to the people. And every day in this capital city, there are hundreds of kids from the toughest neighborhoods who are finally getting a chance at a decent education. I'm proud of these things. But the mission is not complete, but the truth is, it may never be. One thing I came to realize over the years that I've been here is that this battle over the size and scope and cost of our government in Washington has been going on for more than 200 years. And the forces of the status quo go through an awful lot of trouble to prevent change from happening. Real change takes time. Yes, freedom makes all things possible, but patience is what makes all things real. So believe in the long, slow struggle. Believe in this country's ability to meet her challenges and to lead the world. And remember, you can't do a big job alone, especially this one. So I'm grateful to my family. Deb and my two girls were 3 and 1 when I first ran for office. Now they're a lot older. And so they've been through a lot. You all know what your families go through. It's one thing for us to take the bricks and the boards and everything gets thrown at us, but it's another thing for our families. Their thin skin isn't as thick as ours. I'm also grateful to all of my colleagues, my fellow leaders, Mr. McCarthy, Mr. Scalise, Ms. McMorris-Rogers, and many on my side of the aisle, our committee chairs, people I've worked with for a long time. But I'm just as grateful to Ms. Pelosi, Mr. Hoyer, Mr. Clyburn, and Becerra, and others for all of the work that we've done together. And over these last 5 years, we've done an awful lot of work together, probably more work done across the aisle over the last 5 years than in the 25 years that I've served in this institution. Now, as much as I enjoy working with all of you, some of you still could learn to dress better. You know who you are. And I saw one of the usual suspects that shows up here once in a while without a tie. But this morning, he wasn't dressed very well, but he did have a tie on. I'm grateful to the people who work in this institution every day. And whether it's the reading clerks or you know, there are a lot of people, thousands of people, that allow us to do our jobs and to help make this institution what it is. And whether it's the people you see here today or the people in the CAO's office or the Capitol Police or Ledge Council, there really are thousands of people that really do allow us to do our job. I'm grateful to my staff. Now, you all know I'm a big believer in staff. None of us can be what we are without a good staff. And I certainly would never have gotten to this job without having built a great team. And so I really am grateful to my staff, as they like to say to each other, once you're part of Boehnerland, you're always part of Boehnerland. And that certainly goes for me as well. I'm especially grateful to all my constituents and volunteers over the years. That includes a student at Miami University in Oxford, Ohio, in 1990, he was putting up campaign signs for me. His name was Paul Ryan. I didn't think he could pronounce my name back in 1990. He was putting yard signs up for me, but as Cincinnatus understood, there's a difference between being asked to do something and being called to do something. Now, Paul is being called. I know he'll serve with grace and with energy. And I want to wish him and his family all the best. My colleagues, I've described my life as a chase for the American dream. And that chase began at the bottom of the hill just off the main drag in Reading, Ohio, right outside of Cincinnati. The top of the hill was a small house with a big family, a shining city in its own right. The hill had twists, the hill had turns, and even a few tears. Nothing wrong with that. But let me tell you, it was just perfect. Never forget, we're the luckiest people on the earth. In America, you can do anything that you're willing to work for, willing to work hard at, and anything can happen if you're willing to make the necessary sacrifices in life. If you falter, and you will, you can just pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and go do it again. Because hope always springs eternal. And If you just do the right things for the right reasons, good things will happen. And this, too, can really happen to you. God bless you, and God bless our great country. Thank you.